better. I could actually hear you the first time, I just sort of whip you into a frenzy. So the first guest that we have, it is a friend of Ogge. He's been of Ogge UK, he's been here before. He's the former commentator of the semi-finals for the BBC and the presenter of the London Eurovision Party. And for many years, I've fluffed him backstage just when he's ready to go up. So here he is, please give a warm welcome to Paddy O'Connell. A Melody Festival and performer and a national final host. It is. I'm going to introduce her in the only way that I can think to introduce her. The way she introduced herself everywhere in Malmö. Oh, 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 ding dong. It's Krista Siegfrieds.
Hello, hello,
They maybe don't know what they're letting themselves in for, but they are in it together. It's our Eurovision stars from this year. It's Joe and Jay. So welcome. Welcome everybody.
Thank you.
Welcome to Manchester. Welcome back to the UK, Krista.
Thank you. It's so nice to be here.
There are some microphones on the table. So, I'm going to start off. This is the same question as I used to open last year, but it's a good one, so I'm going to go with it again. We are gathered here in this room because we all love Eurovision. It's more than just a one-night-a-year event for us. The people in this room have made friends with other fans. It sometimes dictates where we go for a holiday in May. So Eurovision means a lot to us. So I want to know, what does Eurovision mean to you, Paddy?
Well, I can only sum this up by listening to the group that was called Cock or Van. And I replied, depends what the van's like. Very nice T6 transporter T-line, VW van. So I've had it with cock at Eurovision. So Eurovision for me is the fabulous fans who can put on an event like this. When I first went, it was 50 drunk people in a basement in Birmingham. And Eurovision for me is the fabulous Joe and Jake who enter into the spirit of it. The press aren't on your side, the BBC's complicated, but they put in 177,000% effort. They were so happy people. I loved what they did for us. I don't care when it came, I'm sorry to be rude about the contest. So I love the energy, I love the music, I love the fans. Eurovision for me is heart and soul, and it makes me proud to be British and European.
Eurovision mean to you?
You pretty much said it all, but I love Eurovision. I've been a huge fan ever since I was a little kid. I saw Carola. And she blew my mind. I love it. I loved her.
Everybody else.
Yeah. I love her. And so it was a big dream for me to represent my own country in Eurovision, and when I got to do that, it was quite a shock to meet all of you, because the fans are so, you're so adorable. It was really nice. Since that, it feels like I'm a part of the Eurovision family, and it's really nice to do these gigs here at your like these fan parties. I enjoyed that really much, so thank you. I'm really happy to be here.
Thank you. The voice here, you were both on The Voice as well before Eurovision.
We were, yeah.
Indeed.
Amazing.
But tell me about Eurovision first. What does Eurovision mean to you?
Well, you know, me and Jake, obviously, we've always been fans of Eurovision, I would say, since we were kids, but the fact of the matter is we still are kids, so, you know. No, we both love Eurovision, and, you know, coming into this competition, we had no idea, sort of, how close everyone is. It is literally a massive community, and you know, we're so grateful for the support that everyone gave us, and you know, if we could do it all over again, we would, and we love it, and we'll be watching every year. We just want to say thank you to everyone for supporting us.
Good job. Jake, anything to add to that?
Oh, how do I follow that? No, as Joe said, you know, we're very welcome. You know, we've been accepted into your community as such, and we just received so much support. It was just absolutely amazing, and certainly there's a huge mark in our lives that we're never going to forget. So we're very proud to say we've done Eurovision, and you know, it's something we'll hold with us for the rest of our lives.
Fabulous. I think for me, one of the things that summed up the spirit of Eurovision, I mentioned this to Krista last night, was in the Euroclub on the first, about 3 o'clock in the morning in the Euroclub, Krista's song comes on and she gets up on stage, and I've got a photo of her lip syncing her song into a beer bottle.
Lip syncing my own song. So proud.
But it was just that sense of absolute fun and absolute enjoyment, and that just absolutely captured the spirit of Eurovision for me. It was an amazing moment.
So I had a lot of fun.
Yes, you looked like you were having a lot of fun.
What about the beer bottle?
You mean, what else did I do with the beer bottle?
I didn't mean that.
I was a bit worried whether I should take it smutty today or not, but it's been taken out of my hands.
You have no choice in that matter.
That's good. So I've got a question from the audience, from Ben Robertson, who sent me this in, who's said, what would you look for in a Eurovision performance? Whoever wants to go first? Christy, you've got a mic. What would you look for in the perfect Eurovision performance? What would that be for you? What would you like to see in a Eurovision performance?
Well, I thought that I had the perfect show number, so I don't know what the fuck happened.
What do you like to see?
Well, I would look for youth, and not in a Jimmy Savile sense. I would look because, you know, I don't, with the best way in the world, I don't want Engelbert, I don't want Bonnie, I don't want retreads. I'm sorry. I want Joe and Jake, I want you, I want young people sing a song, to be honest. So youth, then it's got to be staged where it's a television contest. If you wanted to be independently minded, you could say, Joe and Jake, your performance, when you compare it to something else, I bet you were surprised how something else looked on the television. When you look at those Russians in a little box with the television wall and the, whoever it was, you're thinking, does this technology even exist? Because, you know, in Britain, we don't think we have a candle. I'm the Eurovision entry from Britain, and I'm performing with a sparkler from my Christmas cake. I want a song, and I want, but to be honest, I want to come out. I loved your energy. You could never, any artist who performs after us, if they need the Joan Jade enthusiasm, they need to be enthusiastic. So you had a great ding dong.
Thank you.
And I like a ding dong. It's important. You need a bit of camp, you know, what's a chops one from Vienna, didn't she? You need to have a bit of spectacle. You need to have a bit of thing. You can't just drift along like Bonnie Tyler, washed up from some old 90s act. But to go, to be modern and new, you've got to go for it.
Well, we spoke about this obviously when we were rehearsing and stuff. It's like we had so much fun on that stage to start off with, and we wanted the audience to see that, because obviously, you know, we are two best mates, like literally living the dream right now. So I don't know if you watch the performance back just before the final chorus, you actually hear me and Jake like screaming on the stage. We both looked at each other and went, woo! Like that on the stage.
It was more of a masculine scream.
It's nice to see a couple of screamers on the
Eurovision. Yeah, it's got to be fun. I mean, you know, that's what we're all there for. We're all there to have fun, and yeah, we definitely did that. But yeah, we're screamers.
You heard us here first. Exclusive.
Jamie, what of that? Now that's going to be tough. No, I think...
Yeah!
I think...
You're trying to get...
No, I think a good Eurovision act is someone, you know, likeable, you know, that the fans can really relate to and be proud of, for one, a catchy song, great melody, and staging. I think staging is really important, you know, just to try and catch the eye and really try and engage people, you know, not a candle. So
candle is great.
Yeah. So yeah, I think it all relies on the song, but likeability is massive.
Can we just have that scream once more? For both of you. Yeah!
Watch it back, you can hear it. You hear it really quietly. If you look out for it, you see me and Jake, we both look at each other, we're jumping up and down. I do the feminine scream, he does the masculine scream.
You turtles like
that, didn't it? But... Okay, so some of us go to the contest. We have the good fortune to go to the contest, and we get wrapped up in the bubble of being there. We get the whole city experience, we get to see the live shows. But what's it like being in the bubble as an artist? Can you give us a sense of how it was for you?
It's pretty insane. Like, it's pretty insane because, like, you wake up and, like, everything is just kind of set out for you. Like, you know what you're doing, like, every day for the next 2 weeks, which is pretty strange for me.
It's more like 6 months.
Yeah, fair enough. But certainly once we got out to Stockholm, everything was mapped out. But it was brilliant because, like, you go somewhere and you know for a while you're going to engage with so many people and you're going to meet so many new people and just have such good fun. And I think that's what we really tried to focus on more than anything, is just having good fun as great friends. Yeah. See, it was just like... Actually, I even forgot what the question was. No, it was one of them. Like, there was a lot for us to do, and you know, even before the You Decide show, we were rehearsing just as hard as when we were picked. So before the You Decide show, we were rehearsing. I think maybe that helped us to get picked and stuff as well. But we literally had a schedule to do everything. You know, we worked really hard, and it was amazing. And do you know what, by the way, I'm going to say amazing a good 400 or 500 times in this year, so it was amazing.
Amazing! It's like 2006 all over again, that host, didn't she say amazing all the time? Krista, what was it like being in the bubble for you?
Oh, I love the bubble. That's why I did Eurovision, Melody Festival, and hosted UMK. I always want to be there somehow. I think it's so much fun, and we had in Malmö 2013. So much fun with the girls, and when I came home, I was so depressed when it was over. You know, the post-depression, because you have so much fun, and it's just crazy. I don't know anything like that. It's awesome.
Because you liked it so much, you did do it again. You tried to do it again for Sweden this year in the Melody Festival.
Yeah, I really like Melody Festival. I think it's Melody Festival is amazing. I've always been watching it. And I would love to do more, you know, get into the Swedish market and do some music there as well, because my first language is Swedish. So that's why I competed in Melody Festival. I knew I wasn't going to win it, but it was really nice to be a part of it.
Well, that leads me on, because we've got a question from Gareth in the audience, who said, so, you know, doing Melody Festival like that, where it's so difficult to win, is it a good opportunity for you to promote your work?
Yeah, that's exactly what it was. It's like the Eurovision fans knew who I was, but normal people in Sweden don't know. So it was really great for me to be there. You know, in Melody Festival, and just make a good show number and do my best, and then after that I got a record deal with Universal Music Sweden, so you know, thank you, it's
good times.
But I don't think I would have gotten that if it wasn't for Melody Festival, so yes, it's a very good place to be, you know, like 4 million people watching the show, and so yeah, it was really good for me. Good promotion.
It does feel like Melody Festival, it's just such a big thing. It's probably the biggest of the national finals, and it does feel a bit sort of, the goal is not to win, because if you do win, you've got to spend all of your time promoting a Eurovision song, whereas actually, you know, as you say, you get in and you get the chance to promote your new work to a huge and growing international audience now as well. So Paddy, thinking about being in that bubble, You obviously were there in a different role as a commentator, so can you tell us a little bit about what it's like being in that bubble in an official capacity?
Well, nothing prepared me for my first arrival in Istanbul in 2004, because I'd only ever seen it on the television, so I had no idea that it was a festival, a two-week festival, which of course everyone in the room does know. You go and you meet people, and I've met many friends, many of whom in the room, and lovers, many of whom are now dead. And, it's just an extraordinary thing, you can't prepare yourself. One of the things I very vividly remember as I checked into the hotel, the Polat Renaissance Hotel in Istanbul, was the most noisy sex I've ever heard in my life, coming from the room next door. So I naturally fantasized for a week about who it was. You know, was it the backing dancer from Serbia with the Russian vocalist? Who was it? But it turned out when I checked out, it was a couple from Hartlepool on honeymoon. They were straight. So, I thought, my God. And then you meet these fabulous people from all over Europe, you know, you've got those very closeted little gay Eastern people, they're going, I always loved your song, you are still. And then you've got those hot, very, very gay people from the Western countries. It's got this important social aspect. We all know about gay rights, and you're someone who's flown the flag for all of us in that respect. But then also, we win the contest every year because it's in the English language now. So in a way, Britain wins this event. But also, we also shine this light on our country where we're so cross about the fact that we don't win it. So I love the mirror ball of Eurovision, when we look in the mirror and we flash back at ourselves. We obviously want to win it, and we always spend our lives joking about it. But, you know, ultimately, I feel we are winning. It's all hosted in English, it's all sung in English, and you know, one day we will win again. So I love the whole mix. I love the culture, I love the campery, I love the, you know, the people, and I was never prepared for it, and it's quite addictive, and it should be prohibited. It should be banned.
Okay, so it feels like there's a lot of camaraderie and friendships built up when you're competing with theatre artists. It's like, you know, everybody's kind of supporting each other and getting along. But I don't want to know about that, I want gossip. So, who was the diva backstage?
Who, I know exactly who Jake's going to say. I'll let Jake take this one. Who would you have said was a diva in terms of our year of Eurovision?
I know who was the diva your year, because I was in Stockholm.
Go on, who?
Yeah, and I did this for the first time in my life. I did this, you know, like I was the journalist, asked people questions and stuff like that. And that was the first time somebody has been mean to me, you know, like very... So this is now gossip, but... No, what's his name? He was from the Netherlands. Oh. Yes! He was nasty, oh my God.
That would come as a surprise. I think there's probably quite a lot of people in this room who quite liked our ball.
Yeah, but he was good looking, so it's okay, but he was, you know.
He didn't mind so much because he was good looking, it was fine.
Anybody, Monty?
I'm too scared to say.
Jake is
right.
Now, where do I begin?
Right. I'd say, because one of the first events we went to Amsterdam, and we walked into a room, and that was the first time we met any of the other Eurovision acts. And the first thing I heard was the phrase, "Hey, bitches," and it was Hoagie. And then he just... We had to wait about 40 minutes extra for the lady from Albania. We had to wait about 40 minutes for her because she fell asleep. So, no, I think other than that, I think Hobie made up for everybody. I think, yes.
Any more gossip? Paddy, have you got any gossip for me?
Well, gossip, I'd start with the present, which is that Mons Zemelo, I can never say his name, is moving to London. Did you know that? I met him last week in Berlin at an event, and he said he's following his heart, meeting a fabulous woman, and flying to London to be there. Then I remember Andrew Lloyd Webber's year. It was never clear that he was going to play the piano. He was obviously, we said he was, but it wasn't clear because he doesn't always perform. So there was in the hotel, there was a British guy who was there for the rehearsals, training to do the
piano for that song. But in the end, of course, famously, Andrew Lloyd Webber did come, which was a very good idea that he did. Gossip is the question, isn't it? Gossip.
Gossip, yes, gossip.
Javine, I remember, was difficult to get to do interviews. The UK entry from before you were born, actually.
2001.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. She lost her voice, as, of course, famously did Lee Ryan from Blue. One of the best singers in the world, I'm not knocking him. Would that I could.
But,
many people get nervous. Javine was very nervous, I think. Lee was a bit nervous, so there was a bit of gossip there, a bit of diva-esque situations, I remember. And that's sort of half of the of gossip that I've got.
Oh no, it sounds like there's more to be probed out of you. Gossip and those tidbits. I remember Lee Ryan actually, because I remember being at the Og UK party in the place that it was held.
Düsseldorf,
that's right. And Lee Ryan sort of he downed a pint of Guinness in one in front of my very eyes. And I go, that's going to come back and haunt you by the end of the week. And sure enough, in that jury performance, that voice, that note was nowhere near, absolutely nowhere near. But anyway, let's talk about the national finals. Because for the first time since 2008, properly, we had a UK national final this year. We had the choice of the singer in 2009 and 2010, but not the song. So this was the first year since 2008 that the BBC held a national final. So we already have the winners of a song competition from this year, Joe and Jay.
At least we got one under the belt, guys.
You can't win them all, can you? Some of the people in this very room were on the panel, taught this thing, some of those songs, and what a marvellous job you all did. But how did you come to be involved?
Well, this is could be potentially quite long. No, I'll try and shorten this down. No, we started working with management. Once the voice was over for the pair of us, we started working as a duo, just writing as much music as possible. And our manager came across us at one of our gigs. And he said, you know, would you be interested in working with us? So we just kept on working and working. And we needed that kind of break to move forwards because of the voice. We were known as solo acts, but that was it. And it was almost like people didn't believe we were working together. So they can't possibly be doing that. So we needed that kind of
exposure,
that public break. And then the second, you know, the Eurovision New Design Show became a viable option. We were like, we've got to go for it. We've got to do that. And the rest is kind of history.
Sort of just we went for an audition with the producers and sort of got to meet them all and you know, we just sang the song to them and obviously they were quite impressed by it and they were happy with it and we were just being idiots like we usually are and I think they quite like that. So, but yeah, it was good. It was an amazing experience actually because obviously we've been on singing shows and never won, so it's nice to win.
Indeed. Now, last year when we were here we had Electro Velvet and unfortunately for Bianca, it hadn't been the best of experiences. She felt quite knocked by some of the things that she'd read on social media. So I thought, I'm going to turn that a little bit on its head. And boys, do you ever read what's said about you on social media?
All the time. All the time. I've seen some very nice things and I've seen some absolutely terrible things being said. But that's what's good, because we're together, we're just laughing at it all the time, you know, we take it well.
Well, that's good, because I'm going to ask you to read out some tweets.
Oh, great! Fantastic!
I should just give you my iPad and you can flick through. Jake, you can start.
Oh, yes. Now we're talking. Actually think Joe and Jake were really good. Face where it does this. Not just because Joe's fit, though. Cheers, love.
Do you want to swipe to the next one? Okay. I hope I've given you the right photo.
What the hell?
Okay, Joe and Jake, a fit version of Jedward. Hashtag Eurovision. At least they said a fit version of Jedward. They're not really sure. There was a question mark there, so they're not actually sure.
God.
These are brilliant. Right. Graham, we don't give a shit about Joe and Jake. We're distraught. Tommy Heim was robbed. So Queen Dami was robbed. Hashtag Eurovision, hashtag Australia. From London.
We're in this together. Oh crap. They've just set the Tory manifesto to music. Hashtag Eurovision.
Yeah, look at that accent that as well.
Right. Eurovision, you decide. The public votes for stuff like NPS and referenda. This proves we can't let them vote on something as serious as Eurovision.
The British Eurovision entry is a cheeky Nando's in human form.
I like a bit of that peri-peri spice.
Okay, now we've got quite an interesting one from Eurovision Ireland. Are we in the room before we go on with this? Now this is going to be good. We want Joe and Jake Music to box fizz their trousers off. Hashtag Eurovision UK.
Take Garrett Mulhall, pervert.
Okay, so Great Britain was a nice little pop song, and we might not come last this year. I'll take that. Hashtag Eurovision. That's a nice one.
You didn't come last. You didn't. That's very good.
Well, this is another pretty good one, actually, as far as things go. 24th place for the UK. What a heartbreaking result. Easily our best entry in many years. So gutted. Hashtag Eurovision.
See, I was actually really worried that after he read that out, you lot were just going to go, ah! Best entry in years? No chance. Oh, this is from Holly Johnson, actually.
Holly Johnson?
Yes. They did us proud. Hashtag Eurovision.
Yeah, indeed. They did do us proud.
Bit of Michael Ball. Eurovision, you decide. Joe and Jake, good call, I think. What say you?
What say you? Good call?
What say you?
Yes, good call.
Joe and Jake won't win in a million years, but they're kind of adorable.
I'll take that. That's
a lot.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. I didn't have time to look for Paddy. There's a lot to look through for Paddy. Paddy?
Yeah, can I just contribute that actually there's a show in America where the coolest stars in the States read their negative tweets. And so, I mean, it's a really small thing you think you've just done. You just showed up to Manchester and read out some rude tweets. But it takes a really big ability to be able to do that. Anyone who's performed, anyone. And you just take it for granted, but you've really got it. And to do that, it's the right spirit of Eurovision. Everyone thinks they're the funniest person on Twitter, and most of them aren't. And there's a lot of trolling and rude things said all the time. Eurovision is improved by Twitter. It breaks Twitter every year. And your attitude to it is exactly right. You've got to look Twitter in the eye and go, yeah, nice comment. Why don't you fuck yourself with your eye on? You're speaking. So I just think it's fine, it's very good. And I don't know what it's like in hurdy-gurdy land. Basically speaking, I think in the English language, we are mean, because we think it's good to be mean, and everyone's so mean. I'm meaner than you. Oh, I'm much meaner than you, and I'm sexually mean. Oh, yeah. So, I mean, in your country, are people mean on Twitter, or is it just in the English language?
No, people are mean too. I got a tweet a couple of days ago that said that Krista Siegfrieds is so fucking annoying, I would like to put a knife in her eye! So I just retweeted it.
The reason that me and Joe learned to deal with that so well is because no one can take the piss out of each other like we can.
Oh, yeah.
So I don't care what anyone puts on social media, it's not worse than what we say to each other.
There was one I actually took to heart,
wasn't there? Because when we did the You Decide show, you know that little clip that went on Facebook and there was like a still picture of me and Jake with like a 30-second clip of the song? And I used to be quite self-conscious, and then I looked at this picture, I was like, oh, that's a nice picture, that's good. And then the first comment was, Joe looks like Mr. Bean. So I turned around to Joe, Jake, I look like Mr. Bean. He's like,
no, mate, no, no. And he's laughing his head off and I'm looking in the mirror like, oh my God, I look like Mr. B. He's literally in the mirror like,
so much cuter than
you. Oh, thank you, thank you.
Oh, I thought I'm going to go red now.
Well, I'm going to move on. So I want to ask you a little bit about the new scoring system, the new voting system. So I think, I mean, even those of us who are quite seasoned at this business found it a little bit complicated this year. So we've had the 50-50 split of the jury and the televote for some time. But this was the first year that it was read out as two separate halves. So at the top end of the scoreboard, it certainly did what the EBU expected it to do. It was very exciting. It was down to the last couple of votes. But at the other end of the scoreboard, well, it wasn't quite so exciting.
I'll tell you what it did. It built our hopes up. That's what it did.
That's what it did. It built our hopes up completely. But it was exciting to watch, wasn't it? I mean, even for us being there, you know, it was great seeing that name progressively go lower. No, it was, because obviously when it all started, it was like, oh, we're doing really well, and when we got the 12 points and everything, that was brilliant.
Yes, our first 12 points. Our first 12 points since about 1763. From Malta, so grazie half una valletta.
I know we're our next going on holiday.
But it was, because you were, I think you were 17th after the televote, and we were like, we're really excited, and then The sort of the downside of the new system is, like, you know, the UK was read out second and it wasn't very many points, and it was just you just kind of knew it was over then, which was a real shame. How was it in the green room at that time?
It was quite deflating, to be honest. It was pretty deflating, and because there was quite a lot of hype around us from everybody, you know, not just British people, but, you know, every Eurovision fan pretty much ran up to us and was saying, you know, you could really do well this year. And after the rehearsals, the on-stage rehearsals, everyone was saying the same thing, and it was just getting better and better and better. And the closer we actually got to the actual live final, the more hyped it was just building. I mean, even the bookies thought we stood a chance. So we were originally last and went to, like, fourth to win, which was pretty insane. But then, yeah.
But yeah, they're not always right, are they?
It's everyone last to win the UDIS Archer. But no, we thought we'd done really well in the performance and things like that. We came off, we were a little bit emotional. Went back to the green room, and then after the first vote, we were like, this is going quite well. And then, you know, you just start watching the name do that. And then, yeah, let's go get a beer.
I mean, you seem to have taken it in your stride.
Yeah,
as well.
Of course. I mean, the way we see it is, like, with both 21 years old, obviously we wanted to do really well, we wanted to make the UK proud, but how many 21-year-olds can say that they've done that and represented that? Just to represent the UK, full stop, not many people out can say that. That's a dream come true for us in itself. So, you know, regardless of the result, the fact that we were there, represented all you guys and you had all your support, that was the best thing we could have wished for.
Absolutely. Krista, did you like the new scoring system this year? The split televote and the jury vote?
You know what? I was kind of drunk when that happened.
I knew there was a reason I liked you.
So, but yeah, I guess it was good. I don't know.
Paddy, thinking about where, you know, we didn't do well again this year. So I've got a question from Kevin in the audience, which is to you, Paddy. What can the UK do next year to get back in the top three?
Well, I mean, you know, that's like, you know, stock market people, what stocks to follow. I mean, it's really hard. I mean, I do like the new voting system, Stanley, but I don't think the UK is going to be easily voted for. This is the year of Brexit, and you're not going to see an awful lot of love for Adele if she goes up there. She's going to come 10th. So, I mean, basically speaking, I'm afraid I have changed my view. I used to always say politics doesn't enter into it, but this year, Brexit enters into Eurovision. I'm afraid, is my view. I've never said that before about anything. It's so big. Everywhere you go on holiday, you meet people talking to you about the British. And so I think, and you may want to disagree with me, but I think it's a very big year. So I think we need to send something great and humble and looks good on the television and just, you know, allow whoever the artist is to have a good time. Hopefully an experienced person, or hopefully someone with the Teflon support that Joe and Jake give each other. Because you don't have this up there where the Northern Lights twinkle. But we invest, the Beatles, you know, and Pink Floyd and other artists from Britain on the shoulders of everyone we send, you know, and we say, we are pop music, and you go there, and it's just unfathomably difficult, you know. And so for years we never won in the Olympics until we changed our tactics. So ultimately, to answer the question, if you want to come in the top three, probably write the song and sing for another country.
Joe and Jake, do you fancy having a crack at Melody Festival in Sweden?
Well, we did actually make a joke because our producer, when we were working with the BBC, every day, you know, she messages me like, well done today, boys, yeah, you've done really well, really proud of you. And she sent us a text of our big. And then she used to send one every day. And one day I thought, it's got to be good.
You're
going
to have to surname things, otherwise everyone's just going to get very confused.
Ah, I suppose so. Well, obviously my surname is Shakeshaft.
Hey!
You can see the lines.
You can make your own jokes.
You can see where this is going. His surname is Wolford, and Ivan, who represented Belarus, he somehow came into this. And he was like, you know, I think you're going to do really well this year over text. But, well, to be honest, Alan, we've had enough. We've absolutely had enough. We've decided to form a trio with Ivan called Ivan Schaffswald. That didn't go down very well. I thought I'd at least get a bit of a ha-ha, just got a bit of an ellipsis, and I got ignored for about 3 months.
Okay, I want to ask about, and that obviously Eurovision is popular with many people, but it has a strong following with the LGBT community, lesbian, gay, bisexual and trans community. As a gay man myself, I think that one of the reasons for that, yeah. I am. Sorry, if anybody didn't realise. But as a gay man, I think one of the things that we've seen ourselves really well represented, you know, we've had success at the contest. So we've had Drama International as a transgender woman winning. We've had Conchita, a gay man playing a drag queen. We've had UK artists like Duncan James and Katrina from the LGBT community representing us. Krista, you were very, very open in your support for the LGBT community with your performance, because we had the twist of that kiss. Now, you were you did that because you wanted to open the debate about same-sex marriage, and we're going to have that in Finland from March. So, congratulations on your. The LGBT community, it's a divisive issue at Eurovision. In the West, it's sort of, you know, it's very popular amongst those communities, but it's also sort of, you know, we hear the reports of, you know, the contest LGBT following in Russia being used to sort of discriminate against people. We're going to Ukraine next year, which has a questionable human rights record on LGBT people. Why was it important for you to show support for that community?
It was really important because at that time, in 2013, we had this you know, like this issue, are people going to get married? Can homosexuals get married? And so everybody was discussing it at that time. And then we just felt like we want to do something about this. This is Finland now. We're young and this is where we stand. This is what we think. So that's why we wanted to make a statement. And, you know, everybody was asking, are you making a political statement here? And I was like, no. Stupid. Of course we did. We wanted to show the world, we wanted to show Europe that this is Finland and everybody should have the same rights. So I don't regret anything. I think it was the right thing to do. I'm really happy with it, and I think that Finland has made progress, and become a great world.
Controversial. It was claimed that that was the reason that Turkey decided not to broadcast the show after seeing it in the semi-final.
And they also burned my picture in Georgia. What the fuck? Crazy. Russia went crazy. I couldn't believe it. But that's why I thought it was a really good thing to do. You know, stuff like that should be normal. It shouldn't make people so angry.
They burned your picture.
Yeah, in Georgia. They burnt my pictures, they were demonstrating, we're not gonna watch Eurovision this year, I don't wanna show the kiss to my kids, and this is wrong, and it was crazy.
So Eurovision has the opportunity to change some attitudes, but also maybe to embolden some attitudes of, you know, opposition at the same time.
Joe and Jake, you were very vocal about your support for the LGBT community, and you played quite a lot of Pride events through the summer, and I think you know, the support is very welcomed, so thank you for that. When did you first become aware that there was an LGBT following? Was it something you were aware of before you went?
Was it something you were aware of before you did your audition?
Or was it something you became aware of as you started attending fan events?
I mean, we certainly found out about it, yeah. Yeah, of course. I mean, you know, there's Prides in my local area as well and things like that. But obviously, we became a lot more involved in that and support for it when we went for Eurovision, because the support we had, well, off everybody, but quite a lot from the community was insane. You know, we had a huge amount of support, so we just wanted to give that support back, and that's why ever since we've been doing Eurovision, you know, we wanted to kind of show that it didn't just kind of stop there. Thanks for the support, see you later. It was like, that's why we've been playing Prides. Yeah.
It's something that we've done and supported them. It is something we want to carry on doing, because, I mean, let's be honest, I think all the Pride events we've done have been absolutely brilliant. Yeah. And I've just been saying to, like, look, people back home, like, even people that are straight, saying you will have the best time of your life in these Pride events. They're so good, and it's something that we'll continue to support and probably attend, get drunk and enjoy.
Some of your gay humour, I think, at the Eurovision. I think you're one of your most well-remembered lines is looking at the male-dominated audience and saying, all those men have left their wives at home.
And there was Rimi Rimi left. Thing to say is that the bulk of the performers and the mass majority of the viewers and everyone who goes is straight, and there was an understated gayness and then a camp gayness and the camp, so depending on your age it was seen as a sort of secret. But now, interestingly, and this is really because of the Scandinavians, they've taken the gayness and sort of completely owned it. So, you know, you've got, you know, gay is boring now at Eurovision in a way, which I think, if I may say, is good, because actually what we want is what has happened, which is when they, now we have Petra looking at people and just talking about, these are gay people. So it's like, in a way, we're sort of just cantering on, you know, these are musical people, this is a contest. Then there's other jokes, there's jokes about other people. You know, put Corolla, they make Corolla fall into a hole. Something we've all wanted to do. I think, you know, we feel for gay people because many of us grew at a different time, and we know people who were bullied, and we know people who died of awful diseases. So obviously it's an emotional subject, but I think it's evolving, and I think the Scandinavians have helped because they just, so everyone has sex all the time in Scandinavia with anyone. I wouldn't have to be a tree in a wood with some of those Scandinavian people walking past. So I think if you are looking for equality, it means equality of mocking and equality of treatment. So, I mean, I feel that the really interesting thing about the gay issue is that we're all moving at different speeds among the 17,000 countries of Eurovision. And there are really violently homophobic countries, which we went to, Serbia, Moscow. So that's a real story. And Joe and Jake, they are like a lot of British people who are 21. It's just like, it's not the issue it was in 1918. So it's just, there are other things that interest people of 21 now, you know, which is like how many likes they're getting on Facebook, or, you know, can you get a free Nando's black card if you put...
Well, we've asked that so many times.
I told you.
We even asked Scott Mills, can you sort us out one of those black cards?
Right, well, I wouldn't ask him. So, I mean, you're asking the LGBT question. So, I mean, I'm on a stage with three people who've done much more than me for LGBT issues, because they had the stage, they had their moment. So, I mean, I just feel, as an old gay man of 90, I feel like, so, you know, thank you, but also kind of like, great that we're moving on and it's becoming a bit more wrinkled and that we're talking about other things and fun.
Elaine's doing her own jokes down the front.
No, it's good that we laugh at ourselves, it's good that we know that we're not, actually the main contest is about song, singing, it's not, you know, so what I'm really saying is, hooray for these guys, but we need to know that it's more than that. There's more than one colour in the rainbow, appropriately enough. One of the rainbow's colours is the gay colour, but there are many other colours, music, television, youth, you know, great European messages and things and languages. One of the things, I'm going on a bit, but one of the things that always impressed me a lot, and this is my final point, wasn't the gay thing, it was British people singing in foreign languages. I thought like I'd landed on a Star Trek planet, where it's like, you know, that I'd never been told that this was possible, that British people could even speak another language, or even their own. Always learned so much about Eurovision, and the gay story is interesting, but it's not the only one. So there we are. Long story. Hooray for the gays, but get over yourself.
Just think about being there as well. I mean, you said there about sort of, you know, the British people sort of celebrating different languages. Do you think that Eurovision is we celebrate it in a different way than we view the rest of Europe? I mean, the Brexit vote has just happened, and you know, the majority of the country have voted to leave and sort of, you know, turn away from Europe. But Eurovision does bring out as kind of a different sort of sense of appreciation of Europe, do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I do, but I don't want to, you know, go on forever. But I think a good example would be if you come from one of the corners of the UK that isn't English, and you send your local hero, if it's Welsh or Irish or Scottish, there's a real great get behind. If you look at all the Welsh artists, James, name I've forgotten, James Fox from Wales. I mean, and also the Irish, Northern Irish engines and things. People really understand the value of coming from a smaller part of the UK. So yes, I think it's the answer to that question. We do take it differently here in the UK.
I'm going to move on. So I'm thinking of, since Eurovision, what's been going on for you there? So Krista, you mentioned your new recording contract. I believe that when you put it on Instagram, your hashtag was, "So happy I could shit rainbows."
That's what I felt.
So I've got a question from Martin in the audience about that. She says, "Congratulations on the new record contract. Does it mean that we might hear some new music coming soon from you at a certain Swedish music show?"
Well, I don't know anything about that music show, but new music for sure, yeah. I will release my new single 2nd of November.
What's it called?
Be Real.
Be Real? Can we get a preview of it?
No, I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. I'm trying to break an embargo there, but it's not happening.
At the after party, come to my hotel room, let's listen to my new single.
They'll take you up on that offer, they really will. Joe and Jake, what's been happening for you since Eurovision?
Well, yeah, we're still signed to Sony as well, aren't we? So we've been working on loads of different songs. We've recorded bits and bobs, and we've been writing like mad. We're looking, as well as obviously performing and singing, and we're looking at other opportunities, you know, stuff like pantomimes and acting and stuff like that. Hey, he's a fan of pantomimes over there somewhere.
Oh, no, he isn't.
Oh, damn. Well, you won't be getting a ticket.
No, he's behind you.
No, it's good. Yeah. We're just working on all sorts of things, so yeah, I'll leave it there.
Paddy, Eurovision's never really got away for you in a way, I mean...
No, I'm like the cockroach of Eurovision. No, I mean, I think people always... Because I was the launch of BBC Three, I was hired in 2003 as a launch face of digital television, which is now basically dead, you know, digital television. I feel that the commentatorship of the semi-finals is a fabulous thing I'm very proud of. I helped, you know, invent that. I was the first commentator, and we tried to do it in a different way. We tried to love the contest. We did things differently. We made some mistakes. But, I mean, I have just turned 50. So, I mean, I think I'm just happy to slip off a bit from the television side, and I feel myself that I get a lot of work on Radio 2 and Radio 4 from Eurovision, so I'm very happy with that. But I mean it when I say that I think it's important that the contest is a pop contest and youthful, and I feel it's great that Scott Mills is there from Radio 1. He's got a million Twitter followers. And when his day comes, I mean, just bring on younger people, you know. I'm not trying to get my work back as an old commentator. Graham Norton is one of the biggest stars of Eurovision anyway, and he's ours, and of course he's Irish. So you ask me about me, I'll always go to Eurovision because I love it. But I think in terms of working on it, I'm getting work now which is kind of radio work, Radio 2, Radio 4. But I think that if you ask me, as people often do, would I ever go back? I wouldn't. And I think, you know, it'd be great to have, for instance, as commentators, Joe or Jake 1 year, you know, because they know it from the inside. And as this already said, they're 21. And some of the people who are watching are 10. So, I mean, you see different things, don't you? You see different things like roller booties and things like that in Denmark. Well, you've obviously seen them as well, haven't you? So, yes, I've been very gifted to have been involved in Eurovision, and I'll keep going. But you're not going to see me with Petra.
Well, it's a shame because one of the questions from the audience from Martin was Paddy, you were a superb compere at the 60th anniversary conference and at last year's Eurovision party. If you had the opportunity again, would you be the BBC host for the semi-finals? And could you bring along the delightful Nikki French as your co-commentator?
No, I mean, I would love to do it. It's just I don't think I'm the right or the obvious choice. But I mean, everyone in the room is so good. If you look now at Twitter, everyone's commentating all the time. Twitter's really, you can't watch Eurovision without Twitter, I don't know about you. I mean, you are listening to Graham, but you are desperately looking for the great tweets. So it's one of those things that Twitter, it's Eurovision plus Twitter. Is there anyone in the room who watches Eurovision without Twitter? Okay, purists. Okay, interesting. Well, I hope there's time to kill these people. No, I mean, it's a difference of opinion, and it's a minority, but I mean, you're saying, I love the song, I love the dress, and I just want to hear the Swedish woman. Yes, you are. No, that's fair enough, so they're purists. No, we'll just ignore them. About my career, I mean, enough about me already. Amazing place to be, and I keep going.
So, would you do it all again? Krista, I get the sense that yes, you would, because you've already tried.
I love Eurovision, I really do. I think it's amazing, just because it's so much fun. But I'm really happy, as for example, I was hosting the Finnish selection last year, and I thought that was amazing too. And I was in Stockholm watching this year, and I was there working for Yle, the broadcasting company in Finland. So I'm just happy if I can be a small part of it, you know, coming to these parties and be here. Yeah, but never say never.
Can I just ask you, how big was the show in Finland? Was it one night? What did you have to do? What was the viewership? How many people? How many Finns?
Yeah. It's funny because it is huge, and people that say that, well, I'm not watching Eurovision, they still watch it, you know. And Finland, we have 5 million people. Million people were watching the final, so that's a lot. And so we had, last year we had three semi-finals and one semi-final.
Sorry.
And you were moonlighting. You were moonlighting though, Krista, because you had to take the second week off from presenting to fly to wherever it was in Sweden, to appear in Melody Festival London. So in two jobs at once.
Yeah,
and presenting in one country and trying to win for another. Joan Jane, could you do it again?
Yeah, we definitely would. We definitely would. And to be honest, there's a number of things that we've been thinking about doing because, as far as I'm aware, there will be another You Decide show.
Ooh. Oh, don't spark speculation. Not that soon.
All I'm saying, it's going to be next week. You know, all I'm saying is, you never know, keep your eyes peeled. There could be another one because, you know, a lot of people, as of, you know, this year, well, last year, saying it was a success. And if it was, I'm sure we'd like to do something along the lines of either being on the panel or guest performing and something like that. And that's something that we'd really be interested in.
Yeah, we just want to stay involved because, you know, we've enjoyed it so much. Up until now, we just want to stay in the loop, in the Eurovision loop.
In the loop.
And we've actually probably got time for a couple of questions from the floor, if anybody has any burning. Can we maybe take two or three, if anybody's got any?
All questioned out.
Well, in that case, we're almost drawing to a close, but oh, we've got one over there, Danny. Can we get one of those microphones to Danny?
He's keen.
Don't stand in front of the speaker, you know that, don't you?
Okay, my question is to Krista and Georgic. What was going through your mind when you stepped on that stage during the live show, during the final, when you know that there's gazillions of people watching? What went through your mind as you stepped to the stage just before the song started?
Don't fuck up.
That was probably one of the big things, yeah. But we kind of knew when we went out on stage, you know, it would have been an absolute tragedy for us to have really messed things up because we worked so hard on that song. Like I said before we even, you know, went on the You Decide show, we'd pretty much honed that performance ready for the Eurovision final. So, you know, if we were to screw that up,
we would have been going.
There was a lot of emotion in the performance. We both actually cried as soon as we got off stage. Cried.
Well, you know. Like manly tears.
That's really firmly shaking each other's hands and, you know, like tense and all that. But
eating some beef jerky.
There was emotion.
Anybody else? Any other questions from the floor? One at the back.
Having been in it once and having mentioned Jedward, would you consider doing it again next year?
As to?
Absolutely. Why not?
Definitely. I mean, if it was what the public wanted, of course, I mean, we wouldn't want it. We wouldn't want everyone to be like, for God's sake, it's these two knobs again.
You made me so proud to be there this year. I was proud to have a Union Jack flag with me this year. Last year, when I was in Vienna, I was embarrassed.
That was our
but when I saw you guys there, I thought, we've actually chosen you to be there, and I was so, I'm welling up now, just thinking about
thank
it.
Thank you so much, that means the world. Thank you.
Before we close, JP.
Hello, everybody. The question is to Joe and Jake. Very often, countries have bonds with other countries. Did you have a bond with another country, becoming friends? What were your favorites in this country?
Yeah, Joe almost did. Yeah.
Talking about the gossip, I was like, yes, he's not said anything now. You've just bought it up. Like, nice one. Don't you? You're not hearing anything.
Oh. Tanya. I think it was Kiara, actually.
But, we spoke to a lot of people, and that was brilliant. Why did they have to include my name in that? pardon me. Yeah, we got speaking to a lot of people, and there were a lot of really nice people there. Franz, for example, you know, representing Sweden, was a lovely, lovely guy. You know, when we were at the London Eurovision party, he's quite a clean-cut kind of guy. I went, do you want a beer, mate? He's like, I can't. I was like, what do you mean? He went, I'm 17. I went, you're in Britain now, mate, you'll be all right. You'll get away with it, lad.
I was working the bar behind the
That's another reason room. Why you
apologies to you.
Why he was going to get served, because you were there.
I'm telling you, I've
it's amazing how retinol travels.
I had instructions for his father not to serve him any alcohol, so poor kid. Any other questions from the floor? Any one last question? Yes, Brian.
You know, when you're commentating, do you speak to the other commentators first and ask what they think?
Yes, I did. I love the commentary people because I'm a geek. You know, I like the radio and I like all that. I've made very good friends. Andy Canole of Austria is a friend of mine, the Irish commentator. Marty Ding Dong, and last year I was watching the scoring in the vestibule behind the commentary booth, and we were next to the Australians, who were so irritating. As you remember, that old what Danny, where was she? The singer. Who was the who? Dammy. Dammy on her box. What was in that box? Did we ever find that?
Never found out. Was in the box.
The singer. They thought they were going to win, and so in that area there's a lot of people there, and so they were saying, right, who's going to go down if we're called up? Who's going to go down? Are you going to go down? Yeah, I'm going to go down. Get everyone. So I was one of those people going, will you just shut up? I haven't actually won yet, and you're never going to win, because it's all an algorithm which is made to make the Australians think they're going to win anyway. So, I mean, it was just exciting. So yes, to answer your question, you compare notes with commentators, you get tips from the commentators. Some say don't speak over the intros. Some say, you know, try not to be negative about everything, because that was a phase that went through. People were always just unenduringly negative and hilarious about it. Well, the 80s are on the line. They want their hair back. You know, and all these lines we've heard before. Whereas what about saying, what a beautiful song from Serbia. Now, let's just watch this. You know, so, yes. So, I mean, I feel, you know, there's a lot to say. Thank you for raising it. Commentator, it's not a commentator's contest. It's a song contest. So,
yes.
Some great people there, and I'm sure you know some of them. But look at these three. I mean, they should all go again. There should be a triplet. A trio. You should do a trio. You could have a triplet if you want to. You should sing together. You could.
Yeah.
Why not?
We're in this together.
You said it
now. Just have a new super group just being formed on the stage here. Well, thank you all. But before we go, obviously Krista's song was about a wedding, about Marry Me. And I think it's about time that we had some love in the air at Eurovision tonight. So when Krista's going to perform tonight, and when she performs tonight, we're going to have a marriage. We're going to have a marriage. We're going to get two of you in the audience to marry each other. And we're going to select who you are. By Krista's going to take this lovely bouquet of two individual plastic flowers and toss it generally into the crowd and see who catches it. And the two people who catch these flowers are going to get married tonight. Yes, it's my Cilla Black moment.
This isn't even a joke. This is happening.
So, Krista.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. You need to give it a hearty toss into the crowd. One at a time. Yeah. Health and safety, by the way, there's a bit of a sharp end on this, so don't lurch for it if it's coming your way.
Okay.
Who's going to catch it?
You ready? One, two, three.
Okay. Now, which lucky person is going to marry that table?
Look alive, it's coming to you.
Two, three!
These are happy couples! Stand up! Fabulous! Yes, it seems to have left their wives behind. Period, and we'll be getting married this evening. So, well, just thank you for a wonderful panel. So, thank you to Paddy. Thank you to Krista. And thank you to our very own Joe and Jack. We've got some gifts for you, actual gifts. Genuine gifts. Paul's going to come along.
Now I'm excited. As long as it's not Man United top, I'm fine.
No, it's not. We did go for football, we went for the library. So it's Manchester Public Library, if you're late with your book, they give you a t-shirt. So we're very generous.
Thank you.
So we hope you wear them and remember your time at Eurobash.
We've got a break now, I think. A break until 4:10. Break. Have a break.